a song to sing. History doesn't always give record to my claim, but I belong, I was part of every glory, I was there, I was there, and woman is my
October 17th, 1776. I cannot describe the horrors of that night. Fire and sword have come amongst us, and famine is not far off. They aimed to set fire to our town. Children screamed, "Mama, fire, they will kill us." People were running everywhere. Shots whistled over our heads. Those who tried to resist were thrown into the flames. I will never forget the sound of the wounded and dying.
I've got to get to the soldiers' houses before it's too late. They'll set the whole countryside on fire if we don't stop them. Danbury is already burning.
Sybil Ludington was only 16 when she made that historic ride in 1777. She rode through 30 miles of enemy territory, calling out the militia. By dawn, the soldiers were marching toward Danbury, and the British were forced to retreat.
A dark cloud hangs over us. The British are burning our homes and sparing neither women or children. Husbands and sons leave their teams in the fields to go to war. I hear a voice urging me to stand on my own ground and prepare to meet the enemy. I am 19. I want to live free or perish in the attempt.
Under the name of Robert Chertlev, Deborah Sampson fought in many battles for almost 2 years. She was seriously wounded twice. Even so, no one knew she was a woman until she contracted a fever and was taken to the hospital. 6 months after she left the army, she married a farmer by the name of Benjamin Gannett and had 3 children. Like all the other women, Deborah lived under the laws of colonial America, which stated, husband and wife are one person, and that person is the man. Women couldn't own property, keep the wages they earned, or have custody of their children. One woman who spoke out against these laws was Abigail Adams, who did her best to persuade John Adams to include women's rights in the new Constitution.
John, darling.
Yes, dear.
With this new code of laws, which I suppose it is necessary for you to make, I hope you will consider the ladies and be a little more generous than you've been in the past.
Oh. What would you have me do, my darling?
Well, for one thing, don't put unlimited power in the hands of the husbands.
What are you trying to say?
Just that all men would be tyrants if they could.
Is there anything else, my dear?
Indeed, there is. John, if particular care and attention is not paid to the ladies, we are determined to rebel. Oh. We will not hold ourselves bound by any law in which we have no say or representation.
Finished?
No. Men who wish to be happy should willingly exchange the harsh title of master for the more tender one of friend.
My darling, what can I do?
You can think on it, John. After all, you are a wise man.
Perhaps too wise to repeal our masculine system.
Perhaps. I don't understand you. While you're proclaiming peace and goodwill towards men, you insist on absolute power over women.
Can you blame me?
Arbitrary power is like anything else that's unyielding. It's ultimately doomed to failure.
Founding fathers made two mistakes. They refused to recognize women's rights, and they failed to abolish slavery. As the nation grew, so did the yearnings of slaves and of women, who had a single aspiration in common: complete emancipation. It was a time of great ferment and expansion. Our states had doubled. The country's population had tripled, and its wealth had quadrupled. In the tiny factory town of Seneca Falls, Elizabeth Cady Stanton made a radical decision in 1848. She called for the first women's rights convention. She had no way of knowing whether other women would bother to come. She did know, however, that her father would disinherit her if she carried through with her plan.
Father, I want you to look at this.
Are you getting ready to lecture before audiences?
Yes. Yes, I am.
I hope you will never do it during my lifetime. For if you do, be assured of one thing. Your first lecture will be a very expensive one.
I never felt more keenly the degradation of my sex. To think that all in me, of which my father would have felt a proper pride had I been a man, was deeply mortifying to him because I was a woman. That thought has stung me to a fierce determination to go forward and continue to speak out, despite the pressure from all sides. First my father, and now my husband, who has joined those who stand against the causes dearest to my heart. But I am determined. I will both write and speak.
We women worked secretly in the seclusion of our bedchambers because all society was built on the theory that men, not women, earned money, and that men alone supported the family. Every fiber of my being rebelled through all the hours I sat and sewed gloves for a miserable pittance which was then taken from me. I wanted to work, but I wanted to choose my task, and I wanted to keep my wages.
Stanton's call for a convention at Seneca Falls was just the beginning for all women.
Yes, I have dreams like you beyond assuming wifely ritual. I too have thought to touch the moon one day. I have walked the silent morning, hiding from the sky.
have seen the children hungry. I have felt the children cry. Yes, I have dreams like you beyond the cost of social dignity. I think it's time to touch the moon today. Too long the simple mistress, too long the patient maid. Too many dreams I've tasted, wasted, and betrayed. Mother, I am sorry, but I am not afraid. I have a song to sing, I have a story. No gentleman or scholar will proffer it to shame. I will belong and be part of every glory. I'll be there, I'll be there. And woman is my name.
Thank you so much for coming,
no,
Sarah.
Thank you. We've come a long way.
Our convention was a great success. 68 women and 32 men signed their names to a declaration protesting society's treatment of women. We asked for equal rights, including the right to vote. We had set a new force in motion, and other meetings were soon held in Ohio, Indiana, Massachusetts, Pennsylvania, and New York. I confess, if I'd had the slightest premonition of all that was to follow that first convention in Seneca Falls, I don't think I'd have had the courage to risk it. When I saw that stately Quaker girl coming across my lawn, I knew that some happy son of Adam would be set by his ears.
In 1850, Elizabeth Cady Stanton met Susan B. Anthony. Their joint efforts gave the women's movement force and direction for more than half a century.
Her little suitcase, stuffed with facts, had enough proof of injustice to turn any woman's thoughts from stockings and puddings. Day after day, we plotted and planned the coming agitation.
Elizabeth and I wrote addresses for temperance, anti-slavery, educational, and women's rights conventions. We wrote resolutions, protests, appeals, petitions, agricultural reports, and constitutional arguments. We accepted every invitation to speak out on every question in order to maintain women's right to do so.
People say Susan has been my good angel, always pushing and goading me to work, and but for her, I should never have accomplished the little I have. On the other hand, it has been said that I forged the thunderbolts and she fired them.
Stanton stayed at Seneca Falls, writing impassioned pleas for abolition and women's rights, while Susan B. Anthony took her message across the country, from New York to San Francisco, lecturing in churches, schoolhouses, halls, and barns, wherever she could find an audience.
Surely you realize there can never be a true peace in this republic until the civil and political rights of all citizens of African descent and all women are absolutely established. There is no compromise. We demand immediate and complete emancipation.
In 1849, a slave named Harriet Tubman escaped from a plantation in Maryland. 100 miles, tracked by men and dogs, she made her way north, from the Choptank River to Camden, from Camden to Newcastle, from Newcastle to Wilmington.
There was one of two things I have a right to, liberty or death. If I can't have one, I will have the other.
On the sixth day, she crossed the heavily patrolled border into Pennsylvania.
I looked at my hands to see if I was the same person now that I was free. There was such a glory over everything. The sun come like gold through the trees and over the fields. And I felt like I surely must be in heaven. I was free. But I couldn't rest easy thinking of my brothers and my sisters down in the slave quarters, still in bondage. I had seen their tears and heard their groans. Never closed my eyes that I didn't hear the horsemen coming to drag them away. I made me a solemn vow. The Lord helping me, I would bring them all to freedom.
Again and again, she led so many slaves to freedom that slave owners offered $40,000 for her life.
There's a new sun shining and it's something to see, like an angel of freedom calling on. Born I was a slave, but when I die, I'm dying free. There's a new sun shining over me. Gonna take my cheering away from Pharaoh's hand. Gonna give them a learning so that they can stand. All these poor and weary souls safe in freedom land. There's a new sunshine.
They never did catch Harriet Tubman, and she became known as the Moses of her people. When the Civil War was over, women returned to the unresolved problem of women's rights. One of their most celebrated champions was the great evangelist, Sojourner Truth, who drew crowds wherever she spoke. She was never at a loss for the right word. Once a heckler called out, "Old woman, I don't care any more for your talk than I do for the bite of a flea." She looked him in the eye and replied, "Maybe not, but the Lord willing, I'll keep you scratching." When she spoke out for women's rights, she found the issue was an explosive one, especially with the ministers, who became self-appointed spokesmen for women's place in society.
The Bible also says you want others as you have unto you.
This room is fragile.
The Bible also...
Why are we arguing with each other? Why are we searching for answers? The answers are in this book. God shows us the way. Jesus was a man. He was not a woman. And when he chose his disciples, he chose men, not women.
Now that little man in black over there says that a woman can have as much rights as men because Christ was a man. Where did your Christ come from? Where did your Christ come from? From God and a woman. Man had nothing to do with him. Now, if the first woman God created was strong enough to turn the world upside down all alone, us together ought to be able to turn it back and get it right side up again.
Sojourner Truth gave other women the courage not only to speak, but to act. Susan B. Anthony defied the law, cast a vote in a presidential election, was arrested, and denied the right to testify at her own trial because she was a woman. The judge directed the jury to find her guilty. When her lawyers protested and demanded to poll each jury member, Judge Hunt took no chances.
The jury is dismissed. Order in the court. Miss Anthony, have you anything to say before sentence is pronounced?
Yes, Your Honor. Yes, I have many things to say. For in your verdict of guilty, you have trampled underfoot every vital principle of our government. My natural rights, my civil rights, my political rights are ignored.
The court cannot listen to arguments that the prisoner's counsel has already covered.
May it please Your Honor, I am not arguing the question, but simply stating the reasons why sentence cannot, in justice, be pronounced against me. Your denial of my citizen's right to vote is the denial of my right to consent, the denial of my right to a trial by a jury of my peers, the denial of my sacred rights to life, liberty.
The court cannot allow the prisoner to go on.
But Your Honor will not deny me this one and only protest against this high-handed outrage against my citizens' rights.
Prisoner must sit down. The court cannot allow this.
All my prosecutors from the 8th Ward corner grocery store politician who entered the complaint to the U.S. Marshal, the commissioner, the district attorney, the district judge, and Your Honor on the bench. Not one of those men was my peer. Native or foreign, white or black, rich or poor, educated or ignorant, awake or asleep, sober or drunk, each and every man is my political superior. Hence, in no sense, my peer.
The court must insist the prisoner has been tried according to the established forms of law.
Yes, yes, Your Honor, yes, but by laws made by men, interpreted by men, administered by men, in favor of men and against women. May it please Your Honor, I
shall never pay 1 cent of your unjust penalty. All the stock and trade that I possess is the result of publishing my paper, The Revolution, 4 years ago. The sole object of which was to educate all women to do precisely as I have done, to rebel against your man-made, unjust, unconstitutional forms of law, which tax, fine, imprison, hang women while they deny them the right of representation in the government. And I shall continue, work on with might and main to pay every dollar of that honest debt, but not one penny, not one penny will go to this unjust claim. And I shall earnestly and persistently continue to urge all women to the practical recognition of the old revolutionary maxim that resistance to tyranny is obedience to God.
She was fined $100 for voting illegally. Although Anthony never lived to see women get the vote, she died assuring her supporters that failure was impossible. Should give their full attention to the laws of polite society. Avoid gossip. Do not display emotion. Do not ask questions. In the Victorian age, the ideal woman was portrayed as a lady of leisure. All she needed to survive in the world was a good provider. When she married, she was held under common law to be the property of her husband, and she surrendered all her legal rights to him. She was a bird in a gilded cage that sang sweetly, but could not fly because her wings were clipped. A lawyer, Belva Lockwood, tried to change all that. She won the right for women to plead before the Supreme Court. She ran for president at a time when most women didn't have the vote. Her consuming passion was her legal battles on behalf of married women. For under common law, married women had no rights.
Thank you. Shortly after I was admitted to the bar, I undertook the defense of a penniless young woman who had been accused of resisting arrest and shooting a constable. Fortunately, the man's wound was slight. The police had suspected her husband of being a robber. The husband had fled, instructing his wife to refuse entrance to anyone, even the police. He gave her a pistol and told her to use it if necessary. When I talked to my client in the Washington jail, she wept that she only wanted to confess and be punished. I told her, no one has to testify against himself. In the course of the trial, she burst into tears and told the whole story, acknowledging her guilt. I was stunned. I didn't know what to say. I looked at the jury. They were all men, of course. I thought bitterly, that's one of the things that common law did. Kept women off juries. But the thought of common law inspired me. I knew what I was going to say. Gentlemen of the jury, the laws must be upheld. My client has committed the double offense of resisting arrest and shooting an officer of the law. She has admitted it. The District of Columbia is under common law. That law states that a woman must obey her husband. I charge that the husband is the one who shot the officer. After all, you don't want women to resist their husbands. The jury brought in a verdict of not guilty.
For the rest of her life, Belva Lockwood helped women gain legal recognition of rights that would one day make them full citizens. The times were changing. By the turn of the century, 3/4 of the states permitted wives to own property. 2/3 of the states let them keep their earnings, and 7 states granted them an equal share in the guardianship of their children. More and more, women questioned the roles history gave them. The corset became the target of liberated women's scorn. Corset wearers found it hard to breathe or do the simplest chores. They fainted frequently and suffered mysterious illnesses. In striving to prove themselves ladies and superior to working women, the corset wearers reduced their waist as much as 15 inches. Not satisfied with that, Anna Hill, star of the Ziegfeld Follies, had one rib removed and hastened her own death. The changing role of women and the revolution in the arts were all too much for Anthony Comstock, the country's self-proclaimed guardian of public morals and head of the Society for the Suppression of Vice.
Which tends to destroy the dignity of womanhood or to display the female form in an irreverent manner is immoral. No one reveres the female form more than I do. In my opinion, there is nothing more beautiful in the world than the form of a beautiful maiden woman. Nothing. But the proper place for a woman's body to be seen nude is in the privacy of her bedroom, with the blinds down, in the dark. In the 41 years that I've been here, I have convicted enough people to fill a passenger train of 61 coaches. 60 coaches containing 60 passengers each, and the 61st, almost full. All in all, I have destroyed 160 tons of obscene literature.
Anthony Comstock was no joke. He was responsible for the Comstock Law, which prohibited anything considered obscene, lewd, lascivious, filthy, or indecent. And that included birth control information. Anyone who dared send contraceptive advice through the mail, whether a parent or a doctor, could be fined $5,000 and imprisoned for 5 years. By 1919, the Comstock Law had grown so strict that 30 New York City hospitals announced they would not give contraceptive help, even to seriously diseased women. Some women were determined to challenge Anthony Comstock, even if it meant going to jail. It is lonely to die in childbirth. The battle rages inside you. One life struggling against another. Struggling against you. Who had not yet begun to live. Only a few know the fierceness of your struggle, or hear the outrage of your screams. To die in childbirth is a very lonely death.
Dear friend, you have no idea how bad I need your help. I am 38 years old and am the mother of 6 living children and 1 dead. I have had many miscarriages, and in the last 6 years, I have had 4 children and was again in bed with a mishap. Please do be kind and tell me just some little thing that would help me out. I will promise never to give you away so that the law will never get hold of you through any fault of mine.
Margaret Higgins Sanger saw her mother die in her 40s, physically wrecked, having given birth 11 times. As a nurse in the slums of New York, she set up the first birth control clinic in 1916. But police closed the clinic and Sanger went to jail. When she was released, Sanger carried her birth control campaign around the world. Sent to prison 9 times, she served her sentences teaching contraception to other prisoners. Reformers said she hurt the cause by breaking the law. Sanger insisted her first priority was to get scientific facts to the women who needed them most. The promise of a new life brought millions of immigrants to the new land, paying $10 each for a crowded place in steerage. They brought nothing with them but their dreams of a better life. Some fulfilled their dreams. Others fell deeper and deeper in debt as parents and children alike struggled to make a living. People crowded together. 16, 18 hours a day, working for bosses they never saw. They received 50 cents a day, barely enough to pay rent, to buy food. The whole family had to work. it took a tragedy to make the country notice. At the Triangle Waste Company in New York City, owners had locked all exits, fearing that women would steal from the company. When fire broke out, workers discovered that the doors were bolted, and they fled for escape to windows of the 10-story building. Spectators on the street below thought at first that the owners were hurling dress goods to safety. But then they realized with horror that the falling bundles were women. It was all over in a few minutes, and 148 workers lay dead. Conditions in the mines, railroads, and factories were the same. Just as cruel, just as inhuman for men, women, and children. By 1900, 2 million children were working in the mills and mines. The owner said, "Why pay a man a dollar when you can pay a child a dime?" In 1867, yellow fever swept the town of Memphis. The rich left the city, poor stayed, and hundreds died. Out of these slums came a woman who led the workers to a better life. Out of a personal tragedy was born one of our great labor organizers. Mary Harris Jones lost her husband and 4 children in the epidemic. Her grief set her course, and for the next 50 years, she fought against all the evils that afflicted the struggling workers. She was so fiercely protective of their rights that she became known as Mother Jones.
In 1903, the spring, I went to Kensington, Pennsylvania, where 75,000 textile workers were on strike. Of this number, 10,000 were little children, like Abraham here. The workers were striking for higher pay and shorter hours. Every day, little children would come into the union headquarters. Some with a hand off, some with a thumb missing, some with a finger gone from the knuckle down. Stooped little things they were, round-shouldered, puny. Many of those children were not over 10 years of age. Although the law, oh yes, the law, it prohibited them from working before they were 12 years of age. But the law was poorly enforced. And the mothers of these children would oftentimes swear falsely as to the children's ages. On one block in Kensington, 14 women, mothers of 22 children, explained that it was either a question of starvation or perjury, because the fathers had either been killed or maimed in the mines. I asked this newspaper man why they didn't publish the facts about child labor in Pennsylvania, and he said they couldn't, because the mill owners owned stock in the newspapers. I said, well, I've got stock. I've got stock in the children, and I'll get it some publicity.
Mary Harris Jones marched with the children down New York's Fourth Avenue. She organized workers in the railroads, the steel mills, the coal mines, and soon the march became a march of thousands.
I don't believe in women's rights or men's rights, but in human rights. Women should raise hell. Whatever their fight, for God's sake, don't be ladylike.
She was shot at, beaten, and repeatedly jailed, the last time at the age of 89. But she lived to see her dream of a united workers' movement become a reality. After two world wars and a depression, America was ready for a little fun. In the fabulous 50s, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness was a reality for many, but not for the citizens of Montgomery, Alabama.
I have this date instructed the police department of the city of Montgomery to continue to enforce the segregation laws as now written on our books. And as long as I am police commissioner of the city of Montgomery, I expect to follow this procedure.
In 1955, segregation was a way of life in many parts of the country. But one woman decided, as others had before her, that freedom was worth fighting for. Rosa Parks refused to surrender her seat to a white man on a bus in Montgomery, Alabama.
Whites would accuse you of causing trouble when all you were doing was acting like a normal human being instead of cringing. You didn't have to wait for lynching. You died a little each time you found yourself face to face with discrimination. The question of where we had to sit on a bus wasn't a little thing. It was painful to get on a bus and have to pass by all those empty seats up front in order to stand in the rear. The most painful thing of all was to see little children on the bus. To them, a seat was a seat. And when they saw an empty one, they sat down. Their mothers would have to snatch them up and hurry them to the rear before there was trouble. It was painful to think of how they would be talked. They had to stand in the back just because of their color. I knew that someone had to make the first step. And I made up my mind just not to move.
Her courageous act inspired others to take a stand for their beliefs. Great new civil rights crusade swept across the country. Another chapter in the struggle for human dignity that courageous women have fought for over 200 years.
Resistance to tyranny is obedience to God.
Come on, we're going to be free.
I don't believe in women's rights or men's rights. I believe in human rights. Women should raise hell. Whatever their fight, for God's sake, don't be ladylike.
Women struggled for the vote. Women fought against slavery. Women fought for human dignity. Women defended our country. Yes, we have a history, and we should know it. Ida Wells Barnett began the campaign that ended lynching. Astronomer Annie Jump Cannon classified over 200,000 stars. Mary McLeod Bethune founded a college with $1.50. Jane Addams, whose work with immigrants earned her a Nobel Peace Prize. Dr. Mary Walker won the Congressional Medal of Honor. Zitkala Shah organized the National Council of American Indians. Clara Barton founded the American Red Cross. Elizabeth Blackwell, our first doctor who founded the New York Infirmary. Dorothea Dix reformed the treatment of the mentally ill. Georgia O'Keeffe led the modern art movement. Pearl Buck won the Pulitzer Prize and the Nobel Peace Prize for Literature. Dr. Maria Gopert Mayer, who won the Nobel Prize for Physics. Gwendolyn Brooks won the Pulitzer Prize for poetry. Amelia Earhart made the first solo flight from Honolulu to the mainland. She was the first woman to fly the Atlantic alone. Amelia Earhart never came back from her last flight across the Pacific in 1937. However, she left a letter for her husband. Please know, I'm quite aware of the hazard. Women must try to do things as men have tried. When they fail, their failure must be but a challenge to others. A challenge to all of us.